my emotions about the Milwaukee Bucks right now are kind of in the weirdest roller coaster ever. It's so up and down between me thinking at the beginning of the season there was no shot that they even had a chance at the finals to this postseason. I thought they were going to lose to the Heat in the first round. I thought they were going to lose to the Bucks in the second round. I thought they were going to lose to the Hawks in the third round. And especially when Giannis went down, I thought the season was over. And they've proven me wrong every single time up to this point. And now, especially after they beat the Brooklyn Nets, I started to really just hate that Nets team by the end of it. And now the Bucks are in the finals. And even though they're down 0-1, my thought process going into it was that they actually had a really good chance to win this in 7 or 6 games. And they honestly would have been my favorite to win the series. And the thing about the Milwaukee Bucks that made me think that they were actually going to win this series is that after every single milestone during this season, they proved their main deficiency wrong. Through the first round and a majority of the regular season, I thought that the Milwaukee Bucks were too reliant upon Giannis Antetokounmpo, and that the way that he was relied upon was an ineffective and inefficient way for them to be a championship contender. Then after they swept the Miami Heat, I started to think differently. I thought, okay, maybe the way Giannis plays can be a really good way for Milwaukee. Then they go down 0-2 against the Brooklyn Nets, and it's a series in which, you know, Mike Budenholzer, like, he probably, if coaches could get fired during the playoffs, there was a good chance, I mean, I would have fired him at that point and just had someone else do it, because the way that they had got beat in those first two games by the Brooklyn Nets, I'm pretty sure they were like 20-point blowouts each time, if not 20, close to 20. And then they end up winning that series, and Giannis plays incredibly, and Mike Budenholzer actually makes some decent moves rotation-wise, and you know, he just ends up looking like a better coach after coming back in that series. Then Atlanta, the problem was obvious. Giannis goes down. How can you beat a great Atlanta Hawks team without Giannis? And to everyone's surprise, they do it. They beat them 2 straight games and take the series. And so going into this finals, I think the main deficiency about the Bucks was that, and something that I should say about that final round against the Hawks, with Giannis going down and not playing for the Bucks and them winning those 2 games, we saw that Jrue Holiday and Chris Middleton are not bums like I and a lot of people thought that they were during the Nets series, because they just didn't play well. But during that Hawks series, especially towards the end, they really carried the team to that Eastern Conference Finals victory. But now it's the finals, and the main deficiency that is very apparent that I didn't really even see coming, but it has definitely reared its head, is the fact that while Mike Budenholzer has changed, I wouldn't even say he changed, I would say that he got a little bit better during this playoffs about some of the minutes he gives out or some of the players he plays together. Like this whole scheme that they have, and they could easily change it for game 2. I don't know why they wouldn't try to change it for game 1, but the way their personnel matches up and the way that their personnel plays together under Mike Budenholzer's system is just really not good. It's just really bad. It's terrible. You, like, any way that you could think about this Bucks defense, it's bad in that way. First things first, I want to get out the fact that, yes, Jrue Holiday is one of the best on-ball defenders in the NBA. However, when you have Jrue Holiday being the only real consistent threat defensively, outside of maybe PJ Tucker, your defense can only really be as strong as your weakest link. And when they have a defensive lineup out there that is, you know, it's PJ Tucker, it's Jrue Holiday, it's Giannis, it's Chris Middleton, that fifth guy that was in there every time was never able to do anything defensively. And in fact, the fifth guy out there was usually the guy getting picked on the most, whether it was Brook Lopez, it was Bobby Portis, it was Bryn Forbes at times. I think Pat Connaughton got some too. The fifth guy on that team could not do anything defensively. And then when you look at, you know, the offensive side of the ball, I have the same kind of philosophy. The offense can only be as good as your fifth best guy. And when they have somebody like PJ Tucker out there on the floor, PJ Tucker is never going to dribble the ball more than 2 or 3 times. PJ Tucker is never going to take a three that's above the corner or the break. And PJ Tucker is not going to be a guy who can make plays for the rest of the team. So what is PJ Tucker okay at? PJ Tucker can get an offensive rebound every once in a while. He can hit two or three corner threes. I won't say two or three. He could hit four or five corner threes in a game. And that's really it. He presents no threat for this team outside of the corner three ball. And this is the problem that a lot of these guys on this Milwaukee Bucks team actually have. And it's really going to shed an ugly light for this team, because just even throw in Bryn Forbes. Yeah, Bryn Forbes is a decent three-point shooter. He was one of the top three-point shooters in the NBA, if we really want to go there. But if he's on the floor, he's probably one of the worst offensive players on the floor, because if he puts the ball on the deck, I don't think anyone really is that afraid of Bryn Forbes driving to the hoop. I don't think Bryn Forbes really is that comfortable in his own right going to the hoop. And Bryn Forbes just is not that strong of a player if he's having to move off his spot. If you just put him in a stand-up three-point slot, he can knock down some shots. But when you ask Bryn Forbes to do something with the ball, he's not going to be an effective player. Now, when you compare that to the Phoenix Suns, when they bring someone like Cameron Payne off the bench, or they bring someone like even Dario Saric in his own right, I'm not afraid. If I'm a Suns fan, I'm not afraid if Dario Saric has the ball. I'm not afraid if DeAndre Ayton has the ball. I'm not afraid if Jay Crowder has the ball. Definitely not afraid if Chris Paul or Devin Booker have the ball. Mikal Bridges. The only guy I would be somewhat afraid about is if Frank Kaminsky is for some reason in there, or Torrey Craig is in there. That's really the only time. And the only reason Frank Kaminsky is going to play is if Dario Saric stays injured throughout these playoffs. And even with that being said, we saw the Suns go to a really small lineup during the last portion of the game that kind of sealed the game for them until DeAndre Ayton came back in. So even then, I just didn't even mention Cam Johnson. Like, this team has guys that can do everything on the court, not just be specialists like the Milwaukee Bucks have. At this point, if I'm a Milwaukee Bucks fan, which I think is going to end up being the title of this video, I'm not really sure. But at this point, if I'm a Milwaukee Bucks fan, I am probably really sad, because like, this team, I'm not a Bucks fan. I'm a Portland Trail Blazers fan. If you've watched my videos before, you know that. Even if you haven't watched my videos before, you know that now. If I was a Milwaukee Bucks fan, like, this is so sad to watch, especially because Giannis is playing so well. Like, take the free throws out of it. I understand the free throws suck, but take the free throws out of it. Take that portion, like, take that five, not even 5 minutes, take that 2 minute portion out of the game. Giannis played so well tonight. Like, a dude in his first ever NBA Finals game, I think he had 20 and 15, something like that. And he probably had like 5 or 6 assists as well. Actually, I'm going to look this up real quick because I don't want to talk out my ass. So yeah, Giannis Antetokounmpo had 20 points, 17 rebounds, and 4 assists in his first ever Finals game. And he's doing that on a leg that we thought was completely broken. Like, we thought his knee was damaged forever after the last game that he played. And this is what he does in his first game back. And like I said, if I'm a Bucks fan, I'm just sad watching this because, like, there's a real problem with the way that their roster is constructed. They have decent players, but they don't have decent players that fit together well. And, you know, the problem that I talked about with PJ Tucker and Bryn Forbes, the fact that you're really not afraid of them with the ball outside of them just getting to a spot and having a shot that's wide open. Like, I know that especially Bucks fans, NBA fans, do not want to have this conversation, but Jrue Holiday is just not that good of a player at this point in his career. He, like I said, is one of the best defenders in the NBA, but when you just are one of the best defenders in the NBA and three-point wise, you're maybe not even top 15 at your position. Getting to the free throw line is not a strength of his. Getting to the basket is not really a big strength of his. He's big and he's strong. He's an incredible defender. You put him in the fast break, he can do some things. You give him a standalone shot, he can make it at 30-40% clip. But, like, I'm sorry to say it, but he just is not that good of a player. And the same can be said about Chris Middleton. I think Chris Middleton, in terms of actually being able to offensively have his own workload and offensively have his own stretches without Giannis setting him up, Chris Middleton is a bit of a better player than Jrue Holiday. I understand that nobody's going to want to actually say that because it makes you sound like an idiot, but trust me, you're not an idiot if you think that. Chris Middleton can actually handle the ball. Chris Middleton can actually make plays for others. Chris Middleton can actually lead an offense. Chris Middleton can knock down a majority of shots and a lot of contested shots. I mean, Chris Middleton was a big reason that Milwaukee only lost this game by 13 instead of 30 like they looked like they were going to. And I haven't really spent a lot of time on Brook Lopez and Bobby Portis because I honestly would expect that they're not even going to play. Like, if Mike Budenholzer really wants to keep his job, if Mike Budenholzer really wants to win a title with the Milwaukee Bucks, I don't see those guys playing. They're plus minus. I mean, I don't know. Actually, I can look at it right here. Here, let's play a game. Before I find it, the combined plus minus of Chris Middleton, or Brook Lopez and Bobby Portis is going to be like negative 45. Brook Lopez was minus 17, Bobby Portis was minus 10. So between the two of them, they were a minus 27. That's bad. Like, they just were not on the floor producing positive play. And most of it had to do with the fact that defensively they were really bad. But, I mean, they have some of the same issues that I brought up earlier with the other players. With all that being said, that's going to be the video for me. I hope you all enjoyed it. If you did, make sure you leave a like. If you didn't, make sure you leave a dislike. If you're a Milwaukee fan, you probably didn't like the video. You haven't liked the past 24 hours. So I don't blame you, man. Subscribe to the channel, comment, do whatever you want, and I'll see you in the next video, or not. Peace.